This is everyone's responsibility. We all have a role to play, and we need to continue to work collectively in order to resolve these issues and ensure Granite staters across the lifespan have access to the health care they need, including mental health care, when they need it.
It's no secret that New Hampshire is in a mental health crisis. The National Alliance of Mental Health Illness in New Hampshire, often referred to as NAMI, reported that 221,000 adults in New Hampshire have a mental health condition. That's more than five times the population of Concord. But there aren't enough providers to address those conditions or beds available for those experiencing a crisis. We'll discuss the current mental health crisis facing New Hampshire and resources available to Granite staters now on The State We're In. Hello. Welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. Today, we'll examine the most pressing mental health issues facing Granite staters, as well as the Seacoast Media Group and union leaders' partnership in a year-long mental health awareness series. We'll discuss why these issues are so important to New Hampshire residents and what solutions and resources are available for Granite staters. Joining us is Seacoast Media Group's executive editor, Howard Altschiller, union leader president, Brendan McQuaid, NAMI New Hampshire's executive director, Susan Stearns, as well as the guiding spirit of the series, senior director of external affairs, Dartmouth-Hitchcock Health, and former chief justice of the New Hampshire Supreme Court, John Broderick. Thank you all so much for joining us today. So, Howard, let's start with you. How did the series between Seacoast Media Group and the union leader come about, and why did Seacoast Media Group see this as a priority right now?
Well, it starts off with the inspiration for the project, which is John Broderick, and who, as most people in New Hampshire by now know, had spent the past 6 years or so touring schools, high schools, middle schools, pretty much anywhere where teachers and students were gathered, and sharing his own family's story, mental health story, and and connecting with students, hearing what they had to say, learning from them, and at the after 6 years, he had a lot to say and had written a book about the experience and what he had learned, and he asked if we would consider publishing it as a serial. And sight unseen, you know, on behalf of Seacoast, I said yes. And then, of course, it's always easy to say yes, and then you have to work out the details. Justice Broderick thought that Dartmouth Health might be interested in getting involved, since he was working closely with them, and they were. And then, as we talked to Dartmouth Health, they suggested, well, since we have such an important story to tell, do you mind if we reach out to the union leader? And, you know, I work regularly with Brendan through the New Hampshire Press Association. I would have been thrilled to partner with them. And they reached out to the union leader, and they said yes. And the rest has been history. We've done 10 stories at this point, and we have, you know, three more to go in this series. And who knows where we'll go from here.
That's great. And Brendan, how about the union leader? Why team up with the Seacoast Media Group to tell this story?
Well, it's an important story to tell. You know, it's a year-long project for us, for John Broderick. I think it's been about a decade-long project, and we're really coming in at the tail end of that. And it's because of his drive and determination to get more people aware of what's going on with the state of mental health in New Hampshire and beyond, that we were able to come in, team up with Howard to get this series of stories written and to get a lot more information out there to Granite staters.
Great. And John, can you talk to us briefly about how you got in this space and the work you've done regarding mental health over the last several years?
Well, in the last 7 years now, I've put on 100,000 miles. I've spoken to tens of thousands of kids and 350 gyms and auditoriums all over New England. And it has so opened my eyes about what's happening with young people, not just in New Hampshire, it translates across New England, and that we need to start normalizing it, talking about it, dealing with it. And this generation, this younger generation, I love these kids. They're amazing. But a lot of them are suffering with anxiety and depression. They talk to me about it because I'm vulnerable when I speak to them. And they'll talk to one another, but they often don't talk to parents or grandparents because they feel stigmatized by it.
And since you got involved in this work, John, have things changed? Has there been some sort of movement on mental health issues one way or the other?
I think it is changing. I think the ice is breaking out. I mean, the fact that the union leader and Seacoast, I'm indebted to them beyond description, the fact they've devoted a year to this, to Dartmouth Health, doing all they've done, just having a show like this is remarkable and helpful. Yeah, well, changes are coming slowly, but they're coming. I do think people are waking up to the problem. And COVID, which has almost no silver lining, this may be the only one. People are noticing, people are writing, people are talking. It's moving.
And yeah, just a follow-up question on that for you, John. Is that, when you're speaking about what's changed, is it primarily that you are noticing that people are more willing to talk about it, that it is more, just to put a fine point on that, that that's maybe what it sounds like is one of the biggest changes, is people are talking about it more and normalizing it and recognizing it more?
It is. There are other things that are happening, and Susan Stearns knows a lot about those. But what I've been trying to say for the last 7 years, nothing will change until we start talking about it, normalizing it, demythologizing it. The people I'm talking about are our kids, our neighbors, our families. And for generations, as we all know, it's just not been a topic that people want to deal with. I do think that's changing. The younger generation will change it, I'm confident, but I don't want to wait another 20 years.
And this is a question for everyone. What is the most pressing mental health issue facing New Hampshire residents today? Susan, let's start with you, and then Howard, Brendan, and John.
There's no question that the number one reason people call our information and resource line, which is not a crisis line, exactly that information and resource line, here at NAMI New Hampshire, is about struggling to access care. And that can be accessing an initial appointment through a community mental health center or a local private provider, right up to folks who are boarding in emergency departments, an issue that has been going on in our state for over a decade, and waiting for a bed in an inpatient hospital. So that is clearly a huge issue, something that we have certainly seen evolving over the last 3 years, as well as this exacerbated children's mental health crisis in our state. We have definitely seen the impact of the last 3 years, COVID, I believe a lot of the social issues that we have struggled with as a society as well, have had a tremendous impact on the mental health of our youth.
Mm-hmm. And Howard, how about you?
I echo everything that Susan just said. And one thing you hear from a lot of people as I've been talking to them and is the difficulty in accessing. It's not just that the resources aren't out there or that we have a resource shortage, which we do, but you can kind of see the resource that you want to access, and trying to figure out how to get it is incredibly complicated and incredibly difficult. And if you're in crisis or you have a family member in crisis, it shouldn't be so hard to get the help you need. And the other message that comes through loud and clear is that treatment works, and that the people who are able to get the treatment they need benefit from it, you know, the vast majority of the time. But it's very difficult, both because there's a shortage, because there's not a clear pathway to access what you need, and there's just a lot of hurdles to jump through to get where you need to go. And I guess the other things I would point to is there is, there's still the whole issue of stigma that John and Susan and this series have really been trying to address. In terms of, we need to talk about it, and people need to feel comfortable asking for the help that they need. and know that they'll be supported, and know that that is just as if they were having, you know, if they broke a bone or if they were having a heart attack and they needed, you know, physical, mental care. Physical care, mental care is the same thing.
And just a quick follow-up on that, when you're talking about hurdles to accessing that care, can you just give us a few examples of what you're talking about when you say that?
Well, you know, I mean, there's extreme examples of veterans, you know, who are in extreme crisis. And, you know, if they can get to the VA and get to the right VA, and if they have all the proper paperwork filled out, they can get the help they need. But maybe they're, you know, out on the street and in, you know, a form of crisis. And so what people are doing, the state police are doing, as an example, is because sometimes they're the first people to show up on the scene if there's a crisis, is they're being trained to sort of help get resources to people where they are at, as opposed to waiting for the person to, you know, initiate getting the resources for themselves. That would be one example.
And Brendan, what do you think is the biggest crisis?
Yeah, I would just reiterate the access to care problem for people to be able to get the help that they need when they need it. You know, if someone is in what to them is a mental health crisis, and because we have this lack of awareness of mental health problems, sometimes that does not get realized until it's at a later stage. So what we've seen in our reporting and the reporting that Howard and his team have done is, you read stories of people who, you know, they realize they need help, and for them to be able to get help, well, you know, we can get an appointment in 6 months, 9 months. It's not that the resources don't exist, it's that they're not there immediately when the person's having the issue.
Exactly. And John, what do you think?
I agree with what they've said, I do, and there are reasons for it. We don't pay people enough who do mental health work. We don't reimburse them at the same rate that we reimburse others who deal with physical illness. And the best way I could describe it, I think this will help people understand the problem. If somebody listening here today had someone in their family fall and break their leg, we would call 911, that ambulance would come within 10 minutes. If somebody in your family is having a mental health crisis, who do you call? When do they see you? Who pays for that, and for how long? None of those issues are relevant on the broken leg, but they're paralyzing when it comes to mental health. We just don't have the providers, and we don't have an insurance system that underscores that. I know we're supposed to have the same benefits for physical and mental health. Don't kid yourself, we don't. And a lot of those visits are capped. Reimbursement rates are not what they should be. It's a systemic problem, but unless and until enough of us are willing to say, hey, my mother, my father, my cousin, my brother, myself, and I can't get help, and I'm not going to do that anymore, nothing will change.
And just a quick follow-up on that. So if those are some of the identified issues that we know are issues, is there, I mean, I know there's no one silver bullet, but like who should be working on that, you know, addressing those? Who could untangle that? Like, what group? Is it a policy? Is it, you know, mental health providers? Is it hospitals or a combination? What do you think? Like, who should be working on how to address that?
All of the above. Ultimately, it's a policy matter. But my experience in life has been people deal with policy changes when they need to and not an hour before. The President Biden some years ago launched a cancer moonshot, and that has had huge benefits. We need a mental health moonshot in America. What people don't realize, I don't think, is one in five adults and one in five adolescents will have a diagnosable mental health problem in their lifetime. If you do the math on that, it's tens of millions of people. We treat it like it's the occasional problem. And if people listening here were with me at my elbow in auditoriums and gymnasiums, you would be as impatient for change as I am. It's an everywhere, everyday problem. It affects the CEO. It affects the CEO of children. It affects the janitor. It affects all families almost, either directly or indirectly. we are just afraid to deal with it. That's what's got to change.
And Howard, the series has reported on the impact that mental health has had on a variety of different groups. So can you give us the highlights of those articles, and are there any common themes?
Sure. You know, I was thinking of another example that we reported on of someone who couldn't access care, and that is someone who Susan's familiar with through NAMI. It's a retired firefighter from Derry named Todd Donovan, and he spent his entire life struggling with mental illness, and he finally found a treatment that worked, something called TRM, and was receiving it, stopped being in crisis, stopped having voices in his head. And then one day out of the blue, his insurance company said, oh, that's not covered anymore. We don't think it works. And he wound up having a relapse and going to the hospital, which was much, much more expensive than the treatment that he would have received. And it's those kinds of things. And it just, you know, every case, there are similarities in a lot of these things, and there are differences. And it's a big issue across a broad spectrum of people who are having all sorts of different problems. And there just seem to be obstacles everywhere you turn. At the same time, there is progress. And I'm sure we'll talk a little bit about that. Our series started focused on youth, largely because of John's influence. One article we had, the headline was "The Kids Are Not All Right." And it was kids in their own voices talking about what's going on and the pressures they're facing and the anxiety they're feeling. And because the series launched as we were emerging from COVID, I know that had a big influence on things. I had mentioned the piece we did on the veterans, which I found very moving and very frustrating in a way, because we ask so much of our veterans and everyone says the right things, but then when it comes time to help, the help is not always there. We've done stories on student athletes and the pressures that people are on, that student athletes are on under from a very early age, and the expectations that they have on them and the pressure. And these are similar to some academic expectations that some students feel that, are causing them a great stress and anxiety. We've done stories on the elderly and the impact of isolation, and we've covered quite a bit of ground, and really there's so much more that we could be doing going forward. I know I have a story list in my own head of things that I'd like to pursue.
Brendan, have there been any surprises along the way, and did reporters find something you weren't expecting?
For me, the biggest surprise I've seen out of the reporting that we've done is just how many stories there are, and that we've been able to find people in all of these groups who are affected by this crisis in so many different ways. As Howard mentioned, you know, from student athletes to students to the elderly. To a firefighter, you know, sometimes and veterans, some of the people that we think are sort of the toughest mentally out there. Everyone has struggles. Every group has someone who is dealing with mental health as an issue, and it's been surprising for me to see all of those stories. Like talking about the athletes, it's not just student athletes; it's also professional athletes that are dealing with this on a regular basis. And that was talked about in our story. So it's the kind of thing that affects a much wider group of people than you might expect. And, you know, mental health doesn't pull any punches. It doesn't play favorites. It has a wide effect on a lot of different people and groups and everyone in between.
Absolutely. And Susan, to you, can you talk a little bit about the challenges, those seeking help face in New Hampshire?
Well, we talked a little bit about the struggles to access care. I think there's also, and Howard touched on this as well, the difficulties with navigating those systems, that it's can be, when folks are experiencing, or their loved one is, a really challenging time. It can be a very challenging system to try and make your way through. It should be, as folks have said, that you can access that care in a timely fashion. We see problems with systems that are siloed. For example, co-occurring mental health and substance use disorders are extremely common. Yet those are still two separate treatment systems, essentially. There are some places that are doing some great co-occurring work, but we need to make sure that people get that comprehensive integrated care that they need. Similarly, we see often there's a sense in healthcare of, you know, everything above the neck is separate from everything below the neck in terms of primary care is often very separate from mental health care. I don't know about you, last time I looked, my head is connected to my body 24/7. So we need to do better with expanding integrated care. There's been a lot of great foundation laid in the state, but there's more for us to do. And I would be remiss not to talk about the issue of homelessness and access to safe housing. The reality is that if you don't have a safe place to lay your head at night, it's really hard to engage in treatment, let alone be successful in treatment. We need to really make sure that folks experiencing mental health challenges have their basic needs met as well. I also would want to mention, you know, a study came out from the CDC talking about the impact of on our youth, particularly our young girls, who are showing incredibly increased risk of suicide, self-harm. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be worried about our young boys. Those numbers are up as well. And especially children from diverse backgrounds in terms of ethnicity and culture are at greater risk, and also our LGBTQ youth. We know that their risk here is significant in terms of suicide and anxiety, depression, and we need to ensure that we have systems that are designed to meet the needs of all Granite staters and ensure they have timely access to life-saving care.
And Susan, so what resources are available in New Hampshire and what can be done to create change right now?
So, you know, one of the things that I think gives me great hope always is just over a year ago, January 1st of 2022, the state launched its New Hampshire Rapid Response, which includes, for the first time, statewide mobile crisis for both adults and children. Previously, we only had it in certain parts of the state and very little for children. There's a single number you can call, 833-710-6477. You can call or text. The website is nh988.com. You can chat there. That's 24/7. Anyone can access it. They have the ability, if it's appropriate, to dispatch a mobile crisis team to you to respond. They can also assist with a crisis stabilization appointment, perhaps for you or your loved one in the next day or so at your local mental health center, and they can help assess perhaps this is the level that rises to the level that you need to go to the emergency department, or your loved one does. It's a wonderful resource. And it really gives me hope because we were able to stand that up even during this mental health crisis and this pandemic. So we can do hard things. And it has been truly a transformational moment for our systems. In its first year of operation, New Hampshire Rapid Response responded to over 22,000 contacts from individuals and deployed mobile crisis for over 7,000 times. So that is a really great place for us to remember, and everyone can access that. So I always encourage folks to make sure they have that in their back pocket, so to speak. Because it means that any one of us, when we're talking to someone and we have concerns, we have a resource that we can offer. You know, beyond that, the state has 10 community mental health centers. We know there in healthcare across the board, workforce has impacted the ability for timely access, but we do have statewide community mental health centers. And of course, our community hospitals are a resource always for healthcare. I just encourage people to, as they struggle sometimes to access care, to be persistent. And if they're wanting assistance with navigating systems, to please feel free to reach out to our information and resource line staff. which you can find more about at our website, naminh.org. And folks there can help with what are things I might do to try and access care in a timely fashion for myself, for my loved one.
So let's also talk about the state's 10-year mental health plan. Susan, what is the plan and what progress has it made since launching in 2019?
So the 10-year mental health plan has really been our guiding document. And the plan was developed with a broad array of stakeholders, including people with lived experience and families. So it really set forth this roadmap for us. There has been a great deal accomplished. There were 14 priority recommendations in the 10-year mental health plan. They included things like an increase in Medicaid rates. There were increases in Medicaid rates, as the judge referred. Everyone knows everything's cost more. We need to do more. We certainly saw things like rapid response come into play to help address issues around emergency treatment boarding. We've seen expansion of our children's system of care with a program called Fast Forward that provides high fidelity wraparound services to families that have children with the most need. And that is a wonderful resource for our children. Of course, the state purchased Hampstead Hospital to create a state-of-the-art children's facility and residential treatment facility. That is, again, something that happened during this time of COVID, again, speaks to we can indeed move forward with these difficult these big projects, even during difficult times. Further, the state made investment in more transitional housing. They invested as well in expanded housing vouchers through a bridge subsidies program. There have been a step up, step down program was launched. There have been a number of things that have moved forward in the 10-year mental health plan. And there's been a lot of investment. There's no question. The problem is that in the implementation of that 10-year mental health plan in 2019, it was perhaps going to require more even then. And then we had the exacerbation of COVID. So we know that what we have is a wonderful foundation, and we need to build upon that, dig deeper into the 10-year mental health plan, expand it, continue our collective work together. The reality is, this is everyone's responsibility. We all have a role to play, and we need to continue to work collectively in order to resolve these issues and ensure Granite Staters across the lifespan have access to the health care they need, including mental health care, when they need it.
And John, can you tell us about the Five Signs campaign you launched and what the goal of that campaign is?
Sure. The campaign is to really educate kids and adults on the five most common signs of a mental health problem, not diagnostic of a specific problem. But you recall years ago, a lot of people died of strokes and heart attacks, and we didn't know what to look for. We didn't know what was happening. And then we all smartened up, and now we call 911, and thousands of lives have been saved every year. It's not my genius. I wish I could claim it. It's the genius of a psychologist from Maryland who was on Time Magazine's 100 list. One of the things I would like to just add, if I could, for a lot of reasons, I'm not a clinician by any means, but for a lot of reasons, from mental health problems, from adverse childhood experiences to DNA to chemical imbalance, most of the kids I've seen and hugged who have anxiety, I don't think it's caused by that. I think a lot of what I'm seeing is that we have redesigned childhood in America. We've shortened childhood, we've professionalized childhood. The kids I'm hugging are under enormous stress. They're over-organized, they're over-competing. These kids are growing up in a 24/7 universe. None of us did that. And I'm hugging some of the effects of that. I think a lot of what we need is for communities to to stop the high-speed film of 24/7 life and take a look at what's happening to a lot of young people and ask themselves, what can we do to change that? And not all of it requires inpatient treatment. A lot of it requires a trusted adult, and it requires someone who's supportive of them and not judging them every day on their latest grade, their latest club, their varsity sports, how many times, how many minutes they played. There are a lot of people over their skis on a lot of those issues, and it's having an adverse effect on kids. And I think that is a larger discussion, but trust me, it needs to be discussed.
And Howard and Brendan, you're approaching the one-year mark of the series in May. How have readers responded? And let's start with Brendan and then to Howard.
The response has been positive. One of the great things about doing a focused series like this, which the news business broadly calls solution journalism, because it's not just about problems, it's about what people are doing to solve those problems. One of the benefits of that is being able to have longer form content about a particular issue. So rather than sort of a quick hit story, we're able to really dig in and get more depth on the subject. And our readers have responded positively that whether it's relaying their personal stories or just thanking us for bringing more attention to something that they may have dealt with personally.
And Howard, what's next in the series? What do you have planned?
Right now, the union leader is doing the next piece, and they're going to be looking at, what are some of the legislative solutions that are in the works, both at the state and the federal level, and what solutions are not in the works, and that stakeholders think should be at part of the discussion. And then we're going to be circling back at looking at solutions and in April, and then what we've learned, kind of wrapping it all up and maybe talking about where we go from here. I know I had mentioned that there's a lot more to be done. It's, in a way we've addressed mental health care. If you think about it in terms of physical health care, it's such a broad topic. And, I think we could take a much deeper dive into, the issue of eating disorders, which I know are, really painful in a lot of families across the state. I've heard so many heartbreaking stories around those. I'd love to do a story on the history of mental health care in the state and sort of, where we came from and how we got to be where we are now. And then, we talked a lot about the navigation, and I'd like to, there are some people out there who are starting to figure out, who are helping families who are in deep crisis. And what I mean is that lives are at stake, and the problems are not, they require, serious intervention. And I'd love to be able to talk more about how to get people in that situation help. We're off to a nice start. We're raising awareness. Some of the articles are connecting more than others. But I think it's something we just have to keep going. We set out to do a year, but we could go a lot more.
And a final question for everyone. What needs to happen to keep the conversation going? We'll start with Susan, followed by Brendan, Howard, and then John.
So I think one of the things we have to do is really, not let our foot off the gas, so to speak. As was discussed earlier, there is indeed an openness now in talking about these issues around mental illness, substance misuse, and suicide in a way that we have never seen before. It is unprecedented. And I do think part of that is COVID, because of how it has affected so many people. People have opened up and they are talking about these issues in ways we've never seen before. This is an opportunity we need to seize. And I encourage everyone. New Hampshire is a remarkable place in terms of how accessible our policymakers are. Our legislature is in session. There are a number of critical bills before them. I encourage folks to, certainly you can check out NAMI New Hampshire's website and see what we're focusing on. You can also sign up for our public policy alerts that come out weekly. And even if you don't want to do that, just reach out to your legislators and tell them, what's happening to you, to your family, your community, and what matters to you, and make sure they are carrying that message with them to Concord. Again, this requires all of us, and sometimes you have to be a bit of a squeaky wheel.
Brendan, what about you?
So just speaking for the media and specifically, you know, our newsroom, one of the great things about doing a series like this is it is educational and instructional for our readership in keeping them aware of what's going on. But it also is the same for our staff. It makes us aware of what's going on out there in the world. And so even as we are approaching other content areas and other stories, it keeps that in the back of our head. Hey, is this a mental health component to this story?
Howard, what do you think?
Going back to the very beginning, one of the things that Justice Broderick and I talked about when we were just talking about starting this series was doing some community events, getting out and meeting people in person, being there to let them ask their questions, share what's on their mind, and have people, you know, people with good information there to respond. And now that COVID seems to have released us from its grip, it would be really good to get out in person and have these conversations in the community.
Absolutely. And how about you, John?
Yeah, I want to echo what Howard said. Community conversations are critical. You know, we've talked a great deal about the lack of services and sometimes in what we tend not to talk about is why are these problems happening at the level they're happening? Why is it that before COVID, 46% of high school girls were depressed? Before COVID, 2019, 11.3% of high school girls in America attempted suicide one or more times. That's a community conversation. That's a discussion in your church, in your house, in your school. My encouragement and my plea is that parents be willing to engage in community-wide discussions, not only about what services you need, but why is it that we find ourselves at this place? I think there are solutions, but it's going to require a power to say community discussion.
Seacoast Media Group Executive Editor Howard Altschiller, Union Leader President Brendan McQuaid, NAMI New Hampshire's Executive Director Susan Stearns, and Senior Director of External Affairs Dartmouth-Hitchcock Health, and former Chief Justice of New Hampshire Supreme Court John Broderick. Thank you all so much for joining us today and for the work you're doing. The conversation continues online. Have you had an experience with the mental health system in New Hampshire? What was that experience like? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHMentalHealth. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.